Good evening, everyone. My name is Rakhi Mandhania, and I work as a project manager at Colab Cooperative, and I'm also the deputy lead of diversity and inclusion. That's an organizational area at Colab, and I lead that organizational area. Now, the topic that I have chosen for today is designing your workplace using diversity and inclusion and walking on air all the time. I guess the walking on air all the time part is something that you'll probably be able to relate to by the end of this topic, end of the session. But let's talk about diversity and inclusion today. I wanted to be a little slightly more interactive, so I might be asking a few questions, and anything that comes to mind, please feel free to share. A little bit of context of how I got involved into diversity. So being a part of Colab, I get to work with team members located in four different continents on a daily basis. So I work with people from different places, different geographic locations every day. Most of the employees work remotely, although there's an office in New York, Ithaca, but almost everyone works remotely. And that's why I get to work with a lot of people from different backgrounds, different experiences, different cultural beliefs, all kinds of diversity that we can expect to have. And it's been an amazing journey. I've been at this journey for about a year and a half. And I think there are some things that you just always remember. For example, whenever you start something new, whenever you, let's say you join a new firm or you start something new of your own. So when you're part of a new firm, there's usually an onboarding process, you know. And no matter how good, how cool, how fun-filled the onboarding process is, there are always some unwritten rules and some unsaid expectations that nobody tells you about. Nobody gives you a user manual of the do's and the don'ts and the hows, right? So likewise with this session as well, I'm hoping there will be some takeaways from this session, but it wouldn't, unfortunately, it wouldn't be a user manual that tells you exactly what to do if you want to have a diverse and inclusive workforce. But before I even begin to talk about diversity, I actually wanted to share something interesting that happened with me on the way to DrupalCon. So I'm from India, and I was at the New Delhi airport, leaving for Amsterdam. So when you're at the airport, there's this counter that you have to cross where an immigration officer sits and asks you why you're leaving the country. So the same thing happened with me in New Delhi. I was at that counter, and the immigration officer looked at me and asked me a question. What is the purpose of your visit? A very normal question for an immigration officer to ask, so totally fine. And I said, I am going there for a conference. I want to be at a conference in Amsterdam. And the immigration officer looked at me. He looked at my passport. And then he said, Rajasthan. That's the name of the state from where I got my passport issued. So he said, Rajasthan. And then he smiled. And then he looked at me again. And then passed a comment in Hindi, which was, ladkiyan kafi aage ja rahi hai. And that loosely translates to, women are progressing. And then I came to Amsterdam. So there was an immigration officer here as well. And just before me, there was another speaker of DrupalCon who I knew. I'll not divulge into any details of the person, but the person was asked the same question by the immigration officer. What is the purpose of your visit? And the person replied, I'm here for a conference. And the person was cleared to go. Next was my turn. So I went to the counter and I was asked the same question. Again, the very normal question for an immigration officer to ask. What is the purpose of your visit? And I said, I'm here for a conference. He looked at me and then he said, so what are you doing at the conference? And I said, I'm going to be presenting. I am a speaker at this conference. He looked at me again. He paused for a second. And then he said, may I see your invitation letter? And I showed him my invitation letter and then I was cleared to go. Now the first immigration officer made it a point to comment that women from a certain state in India are progressing. And the second immigration officer, for him it was not very easy to believe that I was or I could be a speaker. Maybe it was the way I spoke, maybe it was something I said, something the way I was dressed, I don't know. But it doesn't matter. What I'm trying to say here is each one of us, everyone in this room and everywhere, anywhere, like people around us, they all have their unconscious biases. That's how everyone is brought up, no matter how culturally sensitive you think you are, but there are always some unconscious biases that we all have within ourselves. And it is that unconscious bias that you need to get away with, that you need to keep aside if you want to have a diverse and inclusive workforce. That's like the biggest challenge that we need to have. And it needs to be practiced. It needs to be cultivated as a habit of keeping aside those unconscious biases and then looking at the people we are working with. So this was a quote said by, I think, the CEO of EY. I heard it on some session, some talk that I was listening to, where we say that the only way to be our best is to include our best. And that means looking at the whole world and not just pieces of it. So I know it's very easy sometimes to put together a homogeneous group of people because, you know, we all get the same kind of jokes. We all have the same cultural frame of reference. And when we do, it's just easier to work that way. So I cannot stress enough on the fact that diversity and inclusion as a practice is hard. It requires intentional effort. It requires deliberate work. And it's going to be very difficult in the beginning if we are afraid of change, if we are afraid of being pushed, because diversity inherently pushes us to become better and to become best, right? And I think let's just say that it takes deliberate work, and a lot of companies often have diversity task forces who are entrusted with this responsibility of ensuring there's enough diversity and people feel included. But not everyone has a central definition of diversity. So if I have to ask you, what is your understanding of diversity? Just share anything that comes to mind, anything that you understand by diversity. What does it mean to you? It's just a question for anyone who wants to answer.
Large spectrum of difference.
Okay.
Some categories.
Okay. Any other definition?
Collection of people with different ideologies.
Different ideologies, okay.
People not choosing Drupal.
Yeah, that's a good one. Yes.
Not the same, different beliefs, different the way you look, talk.
The way you look, talk, think.
I mean, diversity could be anything in my opinion. I mean, diversifying it around tech stacks could be anything, right? Mm-hmm. But yeah, contextualizing it with this, I think it's more around people with different culture, different ideologies.
Okay. So I think there is no single definition of diversity that I can give to anyone or anyone can give to me. Because what I understand from diversity in my certain set of circumstances could be very different from what you understand from diversity given your circumstances. But what is important is that every workplace, every organization needs to have a central definition of diversity and it needs to be shared. It's mildly problematic if we talk about diversity as a very generic term, because if we talk about it as a very generic term, then different people import different values from it. And when different people import different values from it, nobody's working in the same direction and nobody has the same set of goals to accomplish. So that's why it's important that we define diversity. And as we define diversity, we see the challenges that come with it. It's obviously challenging, it obviously requires hard work, but we're able to see the challenges. And despite those challenges, when I think why diversity is important, or I have to give my personal opinion of why it's important, then I would say you get rid of your blind spots by having a diverse and inclusive workforce. So for example, if you work with a certain set of people who can all think exactly as you, who can talk exactly as you, who can give solutions the way you would think, in that case, you will all be blind to what they don't know. So it's by having diversity, you get rid of those blind spots. Because with diversity, you have room for all kinds of ideas and inspirations and experiences. So your way of thinking opens up as you have a more diverse workforce. And you become more sensitive. So being sensitive towards other, welcoming everyone else, and the real competence comes out in play when you are in a more diverse work setup. I don't think there's enough needed, or I need to present any numbers in order to establish the importance of diversity, because I think every firm deep down realizes the significance of it. The problem that every firm struggles with, including mine, is the conversion of that intention to action, and not knowing the real steps or what actually we need to do if we want to enforce diversity, or if we want to have diversity as a practice and we want to make people feel included. So we often define diversity, but we don't think about inclusion. This is one question that I wanted to ask every one of you, and I kind of know the answer, but I want to make sure that we all agree on this. So how many of you in this room have ever felt excluded from something, anything in any life experience? If you've ever felt excluded once in your life, please raise your hand. Okay. And the second question is even more important. So let's all be honest to ourselves, but how many of you have been responsible, intentionally or unintentionally, to make someone else feel excluded? Okay, great. So if answer to any one of these questions was yes on your part, I think there is a need for diversity and inclusion, because you know what it feels to have felt excluded, and you know that you've unconsciously, by chance, somehow made someone else feel excluded. So there's a need to practice inclusion. There's a need for diversity and inclusion here. And if we have to focus on the actions, or if we have to focus, we have to bridge the gap between the intention that we had by identifying the need of it to actually going ahead and implementing diversity practices, there's a certain set of things that we can all do, which are very basic, which are very common to everyone, but we probably fail to define these. So I want to focus on the hows as well. And when I want to focus on the hows, the first thing that I would say, something that I've already covered, is sharing a common definition of diversity and inclusion, and sharing it with everyone. Not just with a certain working group, not just with the diversity task force who's entrusted with that responsibility of ensuring diversity, but sharing it with the entire firm. Everyone in the company should be well aware of your definition of diversity. And when you share that definition, we also need to remember that invitation does not mean inclusion. I can invite an entire firm to a meeting, which would probably guarantee diversity, because people from the entire firm, from all over the places, are going to be there in that meeting. But that invitation is not guaranteeing inclusion in any way. Because if only a certain set of people talk or present their viewpoints, then the diverse group that I invited kind of never got to participate. Or even if they wanted to, they had some reservations. And I, as a facilitator, did not do a good enough job to make them feel included. So invitation probably guarantees diversity, but not inclusion. So access is not inclusion. You have to actually make an effort. It's a culture thing. It's more of an impact. Diversity is a numbers game, and companies can mandate diversity. But inclusion is more about an impact, a cultural change that needs to be practiced every day. Having a task force is very important. You can hire a lead to run your diversity and inclusion org area, but it's even better if you have a panel, if you have a group of people, and if those group of people could all be motivated enough to establish and to make ambitious goals around diversity, then it's even better. Because having real matrix to identify your organizational needs is very important. Again, the percentages and the numbers are going to vary from companies to company, but assessing where you are, creating the necessary charts to understand where your diversity stands, and making some ambitious goals for the next year, or for the year after that, or short-term goals, quarterly goals, half-yearly goals, but making some goals and identifying how to achieve those goals is very important. So because we have some real problems, if we don't have a diverse enough workforce, we need to have some real numbers, and more importantly, real consequences. If the salespeople from your company do not perform well, what do? We give them some ultimatum, we ask them to perform better, we discuss with them, but we make sure that the sales targets are still met, right? And what if they're not met? You probably fire them, or I don't know what you do, but there are real consequences if the targets are not met. The business hinders. So diversity is not just a social initiative that we've taken up. It's a real problem, and it needs to have real numbers and real consequences associated with it. At the same time, diversity also means accountability. So the biggest incentive is having a job, and the biggest disincentive is probably losing a job. So ensuring accountability is very, very important in this case. And lastly, making inclusion very inclusive. So for example, I heard someone say yesterday that there's a women in Drupal segment happening, but I'm not going to go, I'm not a woman, so I wouldn't be going. So inclusion has to be inclusive. If I do an initiative for a minority group, but I do not share it with the rest of the majority, or I do not somehow give away the message that I need to make sure that the majority groups work with me for the minority initiatives, till then it wouldn't become a successful event. So inclusion has to be inclusive of all the majority groups, because they are the ones who are supposed to make everyone else feel included. It's never a one-man's job. It's a culture thing as again. So, you know, as you implement these practices, as you go on to setting up a diverse and inclusive workforce, you realize that you've become a leader. And the real job of a leader is not to be in charge, but to be responsible for the people who are in charge. So you get to work with a certain set of people, and they do all the work for you as you become leaders. But your job is to take care of them, not take care of your customers or your products, but to actually take care of the people who are in charge. And I think in conclusion, I would just say that as a business, we have a lot of power to dismantle some of the biggest world problems. So we spend one third of our lives at work. And just imagine the practice to make everyone else feel included. If we do that as a habit at work, we'll probably end up doing the same thing outside work. And we'll probably end up giving the same message to everyone who's not our colleague, but our friends and others. And the world in itself will become a better place. So imagine a world where people of all colors and races and experiences and backgrounds come together to work every day, bring their own authentic self to work without any reservations, because what they bring to the table is different, and that difference is recognized and respected. So that will be the ideal world that we would want to have, and that can only be achieved if we have diversity and inclusion at our workforce. So with this, I think I'd like to conclude, and please feel free to take this survey for the session, and there's contributions opportunities tomorrow, so I hope you all get to participate. Thank you.